Let's jump right in. So the organizers asked me to speak a little bit about some real examples in the case of using alternative data and where we are on the spectrum of nice to have vitamin and painfully need to have morphine. So let's dig right in and do it kind of a Mary Meeker style this morning. So just very briefly, a little bit on Thasos, since there's a lot of different business models in the alternative data market today. Thasos is a pure data analytics firm, and the only data we analyze is data that's geolocation data from mobile phones. So unlike Brian's company, we don't create the data, we source it, and we bring it in-house, and we use that to build our products out of. We've been around for 6 years. We've only had a website for about 3.5 months. And prior to this, I started another whole company that all that company did, a company called Sense Networks. All that company did was analyze geolocation data for the mobile phone carriers. So I've had a little bit of experience, almost 20 years, in doing nothing but analyzing geolocation data. And I can tell you it takes a lot of time, especially when you have something that has to go out to the buy side. It has very high standards for accuracy and precision. So that's why it took us 6 years to develop these products before and work with beta customers and things like that before we even put up a website. So we make the software platform. We deliver daily time series data streams on almost every GIX subsector. And we work with certain fund partners at a lower level. So let's go right into it. What does the data look like? Everyone always wants to see the data, so here you go, it's data. Should be a whole bunch of, you get one number per every day, you get a ticker or a cohort a description on the top, and it's usually some index relevant relative to itself between zero and the number two based on what the heck's going on there, how many hours are being worked in the factory, or how many whatever it is that you're trying to measure. So anyway, don't ever say you didn't see the data, okay? So let's go quickly. So look at this nice gentleman here going in shopping for something for his wife. He doesn't look completely sold on it, right? It's like, am I going to get value out of this? You know, sometimes data starts this way and it ends, you know, the position, for example, that transaction credit card data is right now, where if you're trading Home Depot, you must have transaction data from credit cards, right? It's such a good read. If you don't, you're in huge pain and you're gonna lose your job, right? So somewhere in the middle though, between, you know, is this gonna work? And, you know, I can't do my job without this transaction data that everybody else has. Somewhere in there is the curve where the most alpha comes out of the data set, right? So the competition is really who can first normalize the data, clean the data, use the data with shortest historical time series, right? This is what people expect the most value. Look at like data that's like bid-ask data, right? Or volume price data, right? For 20 years, that data was the worst data set in terms of quality, and the people who cleaned it and normalized it got the most value out of it. But now, of course, it's clean and normalized, and everybody has it, and not the same. So anyway, you want to be, if you're trading Home Depot, this is you, right? And you don't have credit card transaction data. So just to understand the spectrum. So let's go into two exact examples. And by the way, is there a timer here? You don't have to. Could somebody work on the timer? Because I don't think it's working. Anyway, shopping mall REITs. So geolocation data is great for many things. One of the things is shopping mall REITs. It's kind of amazing that in the year 2017, we really have no idea. And even the REIT owners of the shopping malls, and these are $50 billion companies, really have no idea how many people are at the mall. Okay? It's like one of the most basic things ever. So we decided to use the location data, and every once in a while we release some information out publicly, and we released this publicly. And we looked at every single mall of every single REIT operator over $3 billion, and you can see that in the bottom here, some of them were performing quite poorly. So we look at the bottom five, but if you go backwards a little bit and you say that this was the formal release, let's look backwards to what our clients saw in the real-time data, looking at the traffic at these mall REITs, right? So what we have here is if you started looking in November and in December, this is the year-over-year foot traffic to these malls, and this is Taubman and GG. Cyber Property Group and on, which we identified was the five worst performers during this period. Of course, you would have had all the data, but you would have seen, in December, boy, that's kind of interesting that
that the traffic is dropping off.
And so I put a red marker.
Then you see again in February, that's kind of interesting. You know, you see this in the real-time data, you might have think, hey, you know, I would have a $500 million or billion dollars exposure on these mall REITs. Maybe I should take a look at what's going on here.
So if you look at these two red points, you can see that this is where they correspond to approximately, on the stock price graph, of these exact same equities.
And so you can see that, you saw a very clear indication here, some problems, on these five that were not doing so well, because other mall rates were doing just fine. And you can see that, you had some signals here before potentially anyone else of some problems. You see that the number one worst that you saw in our data was TCO, was down 32%. Number two worst that we called out was down 20%. And so this was information based on just the real-time data feeds that we provide. And then another marker is right here. This is actually where we released a public report calling out the five worst that we sent out on our website and into the parent newsletter. So it gives you an idea of a way you can use this data in a new market. So this I really think is a morphine type situation if you trade these kind of equities. Another one, brick and mortar retail. So just a little bit of a different example. Let's look at Amazon Whole Foods. So everybody knows that Amazon bought Whole Foods, and the first thing that they did was they lowered the price on many groceries. And so people were speculating, is that increase in traffic? And so it's amazing that in the world today, it's just impossible to know using any current technology besides this, is that the case? And so what we have here is a chart that shows the whole, very simply, Whole Foods traffic, right? But accurate and precise, right? And so you see the day of the price reduction. You can see before the traffic's around zero. You can see the day after they reduced their prices, their foot traffic went up about 32%, and then it settled. And now today, the foot traffic is back to where it was previously. So you can see that the impact of the promotion was, use your own best judgment. So, this is pretty important when you're looking at the modern world of brick and mortar. And to go on a little bit further, we took the analytics. Beyond that, if you're Amazon and you bought Whole Foods, you want to know all these new customers coming in the door, where are they coming from? Where are they loyal shoppers of? Who am I stealing customers from, right? So you see that the number one that they stole customers from is Walmart. Number two, number three, these are the regular customer bases. As if you were standing on top of every Whole Foods, seeing who the new customers were and surveying them where they came from. But this is not surprising, right? I mean, Walmart has 4,600 stores, right? So I would certainly hope that, if you did anything, that the majority of the people would be a Walmart shopper, right, who's coming to your store. So this is nice. But the thing that's really the morphine is, you need to know, just like in the mall REITs example, something happened, who's getting killed, right? That's a good trade. So in this situation, something happened, who's getting killed, right? Where's the competitive pain, right? So if we normalize this by the size of the competitor bases, what we really want to know is how many of the competitors of Whole Foods, those people, how much of the percent of their regular customer base are they losing to Whole Foods, right? So we normalize it like this, and this becomes a very interesting chart, which I believe is the morphine, that you see that when Amazon Whole Foods did this price lowering, you see that Trader Joe's in the first week was losing almost 10% of their regular customer base to Whole Foods, right? And then Sprouts, 8%, and then on and on down. See, the second bar is the second week, and the third week bar is the third week. And this was an interesting snapshot that we did. We just showed the first 3 weeks. But what I can tell you, because we see the more recent data, is that people watch this in real time, in our real time feeds. And you can see the first week, Trader Joe's was almost 10%, second week, 5%, third week, 6%. That's interesting, but if you have our data, you have the live feeds, you'll see Trader Joe's has gone back up and they're losing 10% now, currently their customers on a daily basis, regular shoppers who are shopping instead at Whole Foods. So the market's dynamics, really, really provides for having real-time data at this point. So again, an example of a morphine. But the trick is, like I said, getting in early on these data sets, because just like credit card data, which is some of the most amazing alternative data in the world, if you wait until it's completely cleaned and normalized and perfect and there's 10 years of history and all that kind of stuff and everyone's using it, the alpha's been sucked out of it, right? But if you get in early, people that made money on this were the people that, you know, took the chances and you know, tried to deal with normalization errors and deal with short histories on the data. This is where the fortunes were made. You know, you can look at the price and volume data, right? Fortunes were made on that when that data was dirty and nasty and hard to use over the last 20 years, and now it's super clean and nice. But in the meantime, you know which funds made all the money on that, and it took 20 years until the alpha was sucked out of it. So, but starting early, you know, when no one else could do it, being the early adopter was the key. So anyway, long story short, also just to make a point that, you know, is it alternative data? You know, when you release that information, and you know, it's for Amazon on the Bloomberg terminal, that it's the number one story, right? So it's hard to make a point that it's alternative. It's not hidden. And so last but not least, location data is a lot of credit card data. You can use it for stuff far beyond consumer transactions, however. So if you look at all the stuff that we measure, I just want to highlight a couple. For example, building products, that's interesting. Because you may want to understand what's going on with housing demand and contractors' demand. And building products is great because they pay with invoices. So you can't get data on that with credit cards or anything else. But by looking at the location data, you can get a read of every single lumber yard and loading dock that deals with that. Manufacturing is another interesting one. There's no real-time data on manufacturing hours worked in the U.S. or anywhere else. So we hear it over and over from our clients. So the product now that looks at the hours worked at every single major manufacturing facility in the U.S., public and non-public. Another thing is hospitals. There's a lot of public hospitals, but you know, nobody has data on it because there's no credit card data, so you can track that in real time, the number of patients. Hotels and resorts, things that use third-party booking services. It doesn't work well with a credit card, but you can look at occupancy and location. And also international, so we're about to release some international products all in Europe and all REITs and retailers. And things like that as well. So, you know, it's very similar to credit card data, but I think it's, you know, adds a new dimension in many ways. So, anyway, that's it. Vitamin or morphine. Any questions, please feel free to ask at the panel, or you can email me, gs@bessosgroup.com. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Greg.